Cancer is a terrifying disease, but with the right knowledge in hand, we can actually do a lot to avoid it. Unfortunately, social media is packed to the brim with nonsense about cancer. This food is going to cure your cancer. That food is going to give you cancer by Tuesday. So in this video, we're going to debunk some of the most common myths about cancer and food, including questions about dairy, red meat, organic, sugar, and many others. Let's go. Number one. Cutting sugar cures cancer. You've probably heard this idea. Cancer cells consume a lot of glucose. They guzzle glucose. So if we just stop eating sugar, we cure cancer. This is a wild overclaim. There's very little evidence to back this up. It's true that cancer cells consume a lot of glucose, but they've also been shown to use fat and even ketones for energy. There's some evidence suggesting a possible benefit of low-carb diets, ketogenic diets, for specific cancer types. For example, glioblastomas, which are a type of brain cancer. But it's not strong evidence. Truth is, we don't know if it's going to provide a benefit, even for these specific cancer types. So it's not yet routinely used in clinical practice. It's also crucial to distinguish between refined carbohydrates, added sugars, so low-quality carbs, things like soda or candy, which have been linked to higher cancer risk, especially if eaten in excess, from whole carbohydrates, quality carbs, things like fruit or whole grains, oats, quinoa, things like that, which are consistently linked to lower cancer risks. If we just lump all carbs together as sugar, that's pretty much walking backwards. There are a number of ongoing trials using low-carb diets, using ketogenic diets for cancer outcomes. So there's a lot of ongoing investigation, but right now, the idea that cutting sugar is going to solve the problem, is going to cure cancer, is just that, an idea. Right now, our best bet is to shoot for an overall healthy diet, low in junk food, high in unprocessed fruits and vegetables, healthy fats, etc., which does have consistent evidence behind it. Number two, dairy gives you cancer. You've got to ditch the dairy. So this one is common to hear in vegan podcasts, some vegan platforms. And the story normally goes, dairy raises your IGF-1, which is a growth factor. So that's going to cause cancer. Case closed. Problem is, this story has more holes than Swiss cheese. Yeah, a little dairy pun. It's true that dairy is associated with a higher risk of prostate cancer, but it's also associated with a lower risk of intestinal cancer, of colorectal cancer. And that link, if anything, is stronger than the link to prostate cancer. So it's a wild oversimplification to say dairy equals cancer. It depends on the type of cancer. Sometimes positive link, sometimes negative link. This is why the American Cancer Society doesn't have specific recommendations for dairy, because it's not clear if the net effect is positive or negative. Now, there's another question that sometimes pops up. This protective link between dairy and colorectal cancer might be due to the calcium content of dairy. And there's some evidence that calcium may play an anti-tumor role, suppressing cell proliferation, for example. So the question is, well, why don't we just get calcium from a non-dairy source then? Leafy greens or soy milk or something like that. That way we get the benefit, lower risk of colorectal cancer, and maybe we dodge that link to prostate cancer. Best of both worlds, right? It's a great question, but in science, we always have to confirm. We always have to test things. We can't just tell millions of people to go do something on a hunch. So first question, do the non-dairy sources of calcium have that link to prostate cancer or not? And some studies indicate that they don't. We don't see that link to higher risk of prostate cancer with non-dairy sources of calcium. So that's good news. Now, do we see the protective link to colorectal cancer with non-dairy calcium? And the data is pretty mixed there. Most studies until recently didn't find this protective link between non-dairy sources of calcium and a lower risk of colorectal cancer, unlike the link with dairy. But this year, year of our Lord 2025, two studies that I've seen already, one in January and I think one in February or March, did suggest that that link might be there, that non-dairy sources of calcium might indeed provide that benefit and lower risk of colorectal cancer. So we don't know exactly why this discrepancy. Some studies suggest the link is not there. Some studies suggest it might be, it's not consistent. One possibility is that Westerners don't consume that much calcium from non-dairy sources. At least historically, most of their calcium was coming from milk and other dairy sources. So maybe it just wasn't enough calcium coming from greens, for example, to see that protective link. Things may be changing now that plant milks are becoming more common, and maybe this is why the more recent studies are seeing a possible link, but this is all speculation. Another possibility is that the calcium from non-dairy sources, like from greens, for example, often comes together with other compounds like oxalates or phytates that can inhibit the absorption of calcium. You can get around that by choosing low oxalate greens, but this is one reason why you might see this inconsistency in the data on non-dairy calcium. So it's theoretically possible that by favoring non-dairy calcium, maybe you can get that protective link of lower colorectal cancer without that possible link to higher prostate cancer. Possible, but we just don't know for sure. If you choose to not consume dairy, make sure you're getting enough calcium from other sources and try to include some low oxalate sources of calcium as well. Things like kale or collard greens are good options. Okay, number three is the superfoods idea. Just eat this food and you're cancer-proof. Just eat blueberries, a ton of them, and it's going to cure your cancer. It's absolutely true that foods like blueberries, turmeric, broccoli are packed with beneficial compounds, antioxidants, and different phytonutrients, but we have no compelling evidence that a single food can block cancer, much less cure it by itself. Again, the best evidence we have presently comes from overall healthy dietary patterns. So absolutely eat some blueberries if you like them, they're great, but don't neglect the rest of your diet. Go easy on things like alcohol, processed meats, that's things like hot dogs, bacon, lunch meats, and added sugars. And try to maintain a healthy body weight. That's also a big, big factor to avoid cancer. Unfortunately, some broccoli or some blueberries can't magically undo the effects of a bad diet. Number four, microwaving food causes cancer. The idea goes that microwaving your food makes it radioactive, and that's going to cause cancer. This idea is rooted in the fact that microwaves do use radiation. Microwaves are a form of radiation, and when we hear radiation, we think Chernobyl, right? But there are many types of radiation. Infrared is radiation. Visible light is a type of radiation. And microwaves are a type of radiation, but it's non-ionizing, low-intensity radiation. It doesn't damage DNA. It doesn't cause cancer. What we do need to watch out for is overcooking or burning foods, whether it's in the microwave or not, over-grilling, especially meats, charring and burning them in the grill. That creates carcinogenic compounds with all these colorful names like heterocyclic amines and polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. Those are the ones consistently linked to cancer risk. And also harmful chemicals that can leach from most plastic containers that are not appropriate to use in the microwave. So make sure to use microwave safe plastics or glass. Number five, eating meat is as bad as smoking. You've probably heard this one. The media loves this headline. Eating this much meat is the same as smoking. It's just as bad. But comparing meat to smoking is a fundamental misunderstanding of risk. This myth stems from the fact that the WHO in their classification of carcinogens put processed red meat, so bacon and hot dogs and beef jerky and things like that, and tobacco in the same category. They're group one, things that are carcinogenic to humans. That group also includes alcohol and plutonium. Unprocessed red meat, by the way, they put in group 2A, probably carcinogenic. But the thing to understand here is these are not categories of size of risk. They're categories of the level of confidence in the evidence. So things in group one all have very compelling evidence indicating that they're carcinogenic. It doesn't mean they're all carcinogenic to the same extent or to the same dose. So for example, processed meat is estimated to raise risk of colorectal cancer, as an example, by 18% for each 50 grams eaten daily. So that's about a hot dog or about two rashers of bacon. But smoking increases lung cancer by 20 or 30 fold. And overall, all types of cancer, the average is about two or three fold. So that's 18% for processed meats and 200% for tobacco, or even 2,000% if we're talking lung cancer specifically. So it's night and day. It's like comparing a revolver to a ballistic missile. Yeah, both are going to hurt, but one flattens your house. Number six, you have to eat organic food. Pesticides will give you cancer. We don't really have compelling evidence of the benefit of organic to reduce cancer risk or much of anything else. There's some studies that suggest a possible benefit. I'm completely open to it. I don't have a horse in this race, but we just don't know either way. We need more evidence. We have much stronger evidence for the benefit of fruits and vegetables to fight cancer, however they're grown. Conventionally raised, organic, whatever. That's a critical thing to explain. Otherwise, we risk scaring people who can't afford to eat everything organic away from eating healthy foods, and that is much more likely to raise their cancer risk. If you prefer to eat organic produce, I've got no problem with that. If you can't afford organic produce or you'd rather not, absolutely eat the apples and the broccoli and the beans and the lettuce, however it's grown. Those foods are going to do much more for your health and to lower your cancer risk than the possible effect of farming technique. It's the exact same story for glyphosate. You'll see this exaggerated in both directions, in my opinion. You'll see people fear-mongering, saying, glyphosate causes cancer. We know that. We don't know that. There's no compelling evidence of glyphosate causing cancer. At the same time, I'm not completely convinced of the safety. I think this is sometimes overstated by factions that try to argue that glyphosate is completely safe, and we know that. I haven't seen the compelling evidence of that. We have a whole video going over this in detail, all the glyphosate studies. For me, I think we need more evidence to be sure. I think it's a crucial part of science to say when we don't know something, when it's a gray area, hey, this is still being figured out. It's partly understood. And it's a critical part of science communication. You tell people what we know, what we don't know, and you let them make their own informed decisions. Number seven, soy causes cancer, especially breast cancer. So this one we do have strong evidence on. So this idea comes from the fact that soy contains something called phytoestrogens. That sounds like estrogen, and estrogen can fuel some types of breast cancer. So it's a reasonable question. Do the phytoestrogens work the same way? Are they also going to raise risk of breast cancer? But the fact is that when we look at human data, we actually see less breast cancer in people who consume more soy. This is especially true. The effect is especially marked in Asian populations where the intake of soy is even larger. We also see less prostate cancer in higher soy consumers. Okay, so how come estrogen seems to do one thing and phytoestrogens in soy seem to do the opposite thing? This is because phytoestrogens have kind of a dual role. In some tissues, they can mimic the role of estrogen, but in other tissues, they do the opposite. They work as a counter-estrogen. This is why we always have to be extremely careful with theories and ideas, even if they're beautiful ideas that sound like they make perfect sense. And we have to always ask and look for the evidence in humans, what actually happens in human beings consuming the food. So in human beings, if anything, soy is protective. It doesn't cause cancer. So this myth is completely flipped with reality. Number eight, you have to eat an alkaline diet to avoid cancer. Alkaline diet cures cancer. This idea comes from the fact that cancer cells grow pretty well in acidic environments in the lab, in petri dishes. So the idea is, let's just avoid acidic foods. Let's eat alkaline foods to alkalinize our body and fight cancer or cure cancer. But the problem is our body regulates the acidity, the pH is what that measure is called, of the blood, of the most compartments of the body very tightly. So studies have shown that different foods can change the pH of your urine to some extent, but not the pH of your blood. And that's a good thing because relatively small changes to the pH of your blood can be life-threatening. They can cause serious conditions like acidosis or alkalosis, and that can land you in the ICU. And even that change in the urine, the change in pH, there's no compelling evidence that that provides a benefit for cancer or anything else, really. A systematic review looked pretty extensively for evidence on this, and they found almost no data on acidity or alkalinity of the diet or alkaline water on risk of cancer. The only study they found looked for a link between the acid load of the diet and bladder cancer, which is a good question because if it's about the pH and the pH in the urine changes a bit, we would expect to see a benefit in the urinary tract, right? That's what's exposed to a different pH when we change our diet. And yet they found no association, no evidence of an effect. So there's no real evidence behind these ideas. Now, that doesn't mean that an alkaline diet is bad or useless. So-called alkaline diets usually emphasize fresh fruits, leafy green vegetables, legumes, nuts, and they also encourage drinking lots of water, and they discourage processed foods, alcohol, and added sugars. So for most Westerners, it's going to be a huge upgrade if they follow some of this advice compared to the slop they normally eat. Not because it's going to alkalinize your body, but because they're healthy foods for the most part. High in fiber, high in vitamins, high in antioxidants, and low in junk. If you want to know more about that link between ketogenic diets, low-carb diets, and cancer, specific types of brain cancer, we made a whole video about that. Check it out right here, and I'll see you in there.